Good evening. Thank you, everybody. Thank you for showing up after a long day of work. So I'm sure those of you who have come straight from the office, thank you. It's a real pleasure to be here today. So I think maybe just taking a quick sort of 2 minutes to speak a bit about myself. I think just one thing I wanted to focus on, the workplace, really, because for me, I think we deal with people. It's always about relationship with people, no? And through my years' experience and in the different areas I've worked, I've really found this to be more and more important. And sometimes just subtle changes to behavior can go a long way. And even, I think, even a journey of self-awareness. Sometimes we're in a hurry doing our job. We're in a hurry doing what we need to get done, and we forgot to take a step back and say, okay, how am I learning? How am I growing? And you know, what can I do to change? What can I do to adapt? So that's really where we're coming from. Thank you for the introduction. So I think just really, this is me in very few points. I have a 13-year-old son, and this is just two photos from our summer vacation. In summer, we just go to the mountains and just switch off for a week before school starts, and then the most painful part of my life, I think. I joined Deloitte as a favor. My father phoned up someone he knew and said, please get her out of the house. We heard about my ISEC traineeship with a pharmaceutical company in Japan. And I remember at the time, my parents were like, okay, you have to get a loan because you're going far. And what if something happens to you? You need money. And obviously, as a student, I had no money. To be fair, that remained quite true for much of my working life. But at this point, my parents were worried about, you know, you have no money. So I went to the bank and got my loan, and then spent 3 months in Tokyo, never touched it, spent 3 days in London and bought all my winter clothes. So suddenly there was a big need to get to work and earn money. So I joined Deloitte, and the truth is, many people ask me, you know, you've been there for so long, how have you been there? And the truth is, I think when you work with brands, with a brand like Deloitte, you get the chance to grow and to learn. And for me, as long as that keeps happening, then I find that it is key for your development, and it is really important. And that's been my journey with Deloitte so far. When I decided to embark on my master's in leadership and organization behavior, it was really driven by a need to learn, to keep learning. I had a lot of experience in the sort of workplace, and I sort of was familiar with a lot of the aspects of HR, but I had never really been exposed formally to it. So this was really the objective of completing it. So just in terms of sort of diving into emotional intelligence. And many of you may be either in a leadership role or in a team where you are being led. The truth is, the majority of us in our roles are dealing with people. So really, the focus today is going to take us on that journey. What is it that emotional intelligence means in that respect? When I sort of wanted to put together sort of some definition, because I really think in terms of what emotional intelligence is, there is a lot of research. As part of my master's, I had taken this aspect and wanted to look at it in terms of what is the impact of emotional intelligence amongst leaders and in leadership, how important is it? And then I went on to do quite a bit of reading around it, because when you have to hand in assignments for university, they want you to read, and they want you to read a lot. So I did that and came across some, so to speak, pioneers of emotional intelligence that really sort of the penny dropped in terms of, okay, what is it that this is all about? What is it? What is it stemming from? And why is this so relevant in context with work in the workplace and behaviors? And these definitions really sort of, to me, struck a chord home, because it's really the ability to monitor one's own feelings. And, you know, when you stop and you think, how often do we do that? How often do we, you know, stop and think and say, okay, how am I actually reacting to this? Hand on heart, probably in the course of a very busy day, we don't, because we don't have the time to. Or when something has happened, you know, an incident has happened, and you say, okay, how often do we say, let me rethink what happened? Let me replay the whole incident in my mind. Let me see, could I have done something better? Or even if you have a member of your team where you're trying to guide, how could I train them better? So really just these definitions, and as we mentioned before, we will share with you the slides and even extracts of the book and which books I've referred to for the purpose of this presentation. And what we're talking about is really emotional knowledge. How well are we understanding? How well are we understanding so as to regulate our behavior? And the concept of self-regulation, if you like, sometimes may come easy to you, but to some people may actually be a struggle, because self-regulating on impulse is sometimes not so easy to do, especially when you are in specific situations. So sometimes you might have a desire to act out impulsively, but common sense somewhere will be telling you, you know what, think a bit. I'm sure you've all at one point received a letter or an email, and you're there, you know, caps on, and you're ready to attack with an email, and you're typing and hitting that keyboard, or, you know, typing out your response. And then, you know, you think, okay, actually, let me just not send this. It's safer if I just send it to myself and maybe think about it, because, you know, maybe sending this is going to take me down a path. But at the time, you're convinced this is the way to go. I'm right, and I'm going to fight this. You know, but sometimes it's a sort of like a bit of an alarm saying, just hold off. So Maya and Salovey were two people who went on to define, and so was Daniel Goleman. And Goleman speaks a bit about, I mean, a similar and related description about the recognition of your own feelings. And for motivating ourselves, and this is another key area about, you know, what is it that drives you? What is it that motivates you to give your best? What is it that motivates you to push your team or to follow the person that you are leading? And sometimes it's not so simple as to say, okay, I know what it is. Sometimes it is a question of saying, okay, I really need to think about it, and what motivates me might not necessarily motivate you. This is all very personal. In fact, what I really like about emotional intelligence is that it is so personal to you. This is not about one is right, one is wrong. It is typically very much how you adapt and how you behave. I think what sort of one of the key sort of areas and components that I'm going to look at today is in leadership. And I find that, and it's something, so in my role, along with my team, we are responsible for recruiting people. And very often, just, I think, out of really trying to understand what can we do better to attract people, and what is it that people want. Today, I came here from the office, and Shelley, who's sitting in the back, is one of my team. We left the rest of the office all doing aerobics in the car park, because it's well-being week. And sort of quite happy I had to come here and not run around the car park in my exercise gear. But I think that the challenge is always, what is it that really attracts people? And very often, when it comes down to the grassroots, it's there's the good to have, and then there are the fundamentals. And this is one of, for me, the fundamentals when it comes to, who are you learning from? Who are you being inspired from? What do you want to learn to progress? Today, maybe, we might not necessarily be in a leadership position, but ultimately, if you're growing your career, you want to aspire to be able to move forward, or you want to be led by somebody who can recognize and display these abilities with a view to be able to teach you and to give you more, and to give you a career more aligned to what you're looking for. So when we look at sort of, you know, what are the skills and sort of what skills are needed today, and I took the following slide from an article written by Daniel Goleman around what makes a leader. And his take on it, and this is after having done a lot of research, is there's a point where in your career you are growing technically. So you're doing well, you're learning, you're technically becoming quite strong, and so your career progresses. But then there is a point where the technical is almost expected, it's almost given. You've got this far because you have these years of experience, and you're almost expected. Like, don't get too excited because you have technical experience, because we expect you to have. But then the challenge is the next step. And what they found in the study is that the people who really excelled and the people who really shone as the really good leaders were not the ones who were just technically very competent, but the ones that really displayed the emotional intelligence skills. And just a very sort of quick overview of the components of intelligence, emotional intelligence at work, really, when you look at these, you say, okay, what does this mean? But when you begin to dig down into it, you realize that a lot of it is really common sense. It's not something that you've never heard before. It's just a matter of reading it and becoming familiar. But when you hear about them, you say, okay, this I know, this I see in my manager, this I see in myself, this I see, okay, that's what they do. And, you know, you can see behaviors that you may agree to, you may not, you may disagree with. So just taking you briefly through them, the first is really around self-awareness. So, you know, the ability to recognize your own moods. I was reading a book kindly lent to me by a friend of mine, and one of the chapters was Carry Your Weather. I was like, carry your weather. They're like, if you're going to walk around with an umbrella on your head and it's thundering and raining, then it's going to rain everywhere. You know, you need to take the sun with you. And I took that analogy into the working world and your daily routine at the office, and it's so true. If you walk in and you're grumpy, your team all end up grumpy. If you walk in and you're pushing and you're driving and you're giving energy, then that is reflective. It's a bit like being in customer service as well. You smile and, you know, people feel that, you know, you're actually wanting to help. This positivity, you're scowling at them like, why are you stopping me, why are you disturbing me from my break, or I'm texting, or I'm busy. You give off the different message. So really it is about that, recognizing the emotions and the effect it has on others as well. So, you know, when we speak about sort of people being able to have a sort of sense of humor and laugh at themselves, maybe they speak with confidence and they are realistic in their self-assessment. And I think transparency and truthfulness, I don't know if it happens to you, but I think you know where you're good and you know where you're not so good. And then the decision to actually do something about it is really your choice. But I think very often the ability to just be honest with yourself about, you know, what is your strength and maybe where you need the guidance and the help also helps in this process. Self-regulation, I mean, I've touched on slightly before, but what I just wanted to mention here is I really think the think before acting and the ability to suspend judgment is really key. Because I think it really does, I always say, how you behave and how you reflect and sort of behave and react to situations will be then what will drive the behavior going forward. So very often, if, for example, we always say, as an HR team, we're there to restore calm, you know, so sometimes there's some major issue where somebody would feel it's a big issue for them, and you're there to sort of restore calm and reassure. And this is what self-regulation also, where it comes into play, you know. Changes, I mean, who of you don't experience change? I'm sure, no doubt, that at any point you have this element of change happening within the organization that you work, and how you adapt to it will depend a lot on how you deal with it and how you process it. If I had to ask you all what motivates you today, what is it that motivates you in your job? You would probably all give very different reasons. Some would be the financial, some would be that sense of achievement that no amount of money can really quantify. Yes, of course you work for money, but then it is the sense of achievement and the sense of really going the extra mile and taking people with you. And that as a strong element of emotional intelligence, because even when the chips are all down, you know, when it's all falling down and it's like, oh my God, get me out of here, having that strong motivation to say, you know what, it's all coming to pieces, but we're going to get through this and we're going to keep going. And I think that is a very strong skill to have and to display. And even to those people around you who are maybe not as optimistic, I think looking to you and seeing that you have that confidence and you have that optimism just allows people to feel more comfort in specific situations. Empathy, I think really the skill is in understanding people's emotional reactions to be able to treat them, with how they want to be treated rather than how you think it's best. I think it's also having an understanding of what that person is feeling and recognizing how, as a leader, you would need to recognize people's emotions and act upon them and not just bypass them totally. And it's not a question of don't do that because he's going to get offended. He's going to shout. Let's not do that. It's not that. It's really just in the decision-making process, you're taking decisions all day long. You're doing things all day long. Just recognizing the importance of people's emotions. Ultimately, we all deal with people on a daily basis. And it is about nurturing those relationships. Whichever position you're in, you may not necessarily be in a leadership position, but even about adapting your behavior with others. And the last one is the social skills. And what I find particularly interesting about this is social skills is not, you know, I'm happy to chat to you when we meet and we can talk all day long. It's your ability to use that skill to influence, to network, and to get to where you need to in a way that people want to buy into where your vision is taking them. And I think that sometimes is sort of underestimated, but a lot of the time, if you are trying to drive behavior, if you are trying to get people to buy into your vision and to your goal, that your ability to persuade sometimes and to convince because you feel it is right and because you feel it is for the good of the team is key. What's really all those basic, these five components have given sort of, you know, what are the components that really give a leader, you know, the skills they need to be and a very effective one. So just really taking a deep dive and just looking, giving you examples, because I think sometimes it's easier to understand with examples rather than just purely speaking. But for example, with the understanding of one's strengths and one's weaknesses and what needs and what drives, I think there is very often the opportunity to say, okay, this is clearly, by being more self-aware, I am being honest with myself that I could be very strong in this area, but I need to focus on other areas of skill. So in terms of my development, in terms of, for example, if I am the person who I know is terrible with deadlines, then I know I should plan for these deadlines better so I don't have chaos at the end. If I am the person working with the demanding client who shouts at me, who is angry all the time, who puts unrealistic deadlines on me, then I know I have to understand the deeper reasons for that and where it's coming from rather than just simply saying, you know, no, I don't want to work with this client. I think also with for example, somebody with a deep sense of self-awareness would have no problem in speaking, for example, about, you know, where they've failed and where they've succeeded, because it's truly specific to them. And the same way in a performance review, for example, where their assessment, their performance is being discussed, they would welcome the objective criticism or objective feedback, if you like, more than criticism in terms of, listen, this is where I think you could do better. This is where I think you could work on to improve. Now, when somebody sits you down and does that, I think the challenge is then how do you take that feedback? Do you take it as he doesn't like me, he's being like this because he doesn't like me and he doesn't want me to succeed? Or is he really taking an interest in my personal development and giving me the feedback I need to succeed? And a leader who wants their team to succeed will ultimately do what they can to drive that behavior, to help make people more aware. With self-regulation, I think the sort of ability to stop and pause becomes key in sort of people wanting to stop, reflect, and think. Because of sometimes the consequences, I feel, could be avoided if you just take the time to literally say, you know, I'm going to stop, I'm going to give this some time, I'm going to think about it, I'm going to really understand it in a manner that is objective, not in a personal manner that this is something personal specific to me, but really to understand, okay, this is the reason why. I had, when I was at university, we had to do a thesis, obviously, University of Malta, my fourth year management, and I did mine with an organization, and I focused on the relocation of the offices and the people flow and the paper flow and the furniture. And the person I was working with, he really didn't like me. So I would walk into the office, you know, you're a student, like a bit scared, and sort of I'd walk in and he'd roar at me. Now, I'm not very small, but he'd still roar at me because he was much taller than me. And he was like, I don't want you here. And he didn't really mince his words. He was like, I don't want you here, and I don't want you to move me out of my office, so go away. I was like, okay, but I have a degree to get, so I need to stay. I just finish my thesis and I'll be off. But really understanding the behavior and understanding what was pushing and driving his reaction to me was really a lesson to me to learn, and it took me a bit of time. I mean, as a clumsy student in the beginning, I didn't quite get it, so I was like probably making it worse and making him like me even less. The same happened when I ended up in Tokyo. So I end up in this country where nobody said any word of English except good morning, whatever time of day it was. And I decided, let's go for thinking outside the box. We won't go to Europe, we'll go far. And then I started working. And over there, the cultural awareness and the global, the totally different behavior, it took a lot of self-awareness to realize where I was really messing up and where I had to suddenly start adapting my behavior. So things like where you sit, who says hello first, who sits where in the room, who bows first, and all these things. And you're thinking, okay, we take so many things for granted when we're dealing with people, and when we're interacting with people, and when there are relationships with people you may not necessarily know. It makes a big difference, and the impact is there. We spoke already a bit about motivation, and I think one interesting point over here that I really like is around sort of what drives you. And when I did my thesis, I wanted to focus, because we work in a professional services firm, I wanted to understand the founding partners, the people who built Deloitte in Malta. What was it that got them to where they were? So I did one-on-one interviews with all the partners, and I used them as the basis of my studies. And one question I asked them is, what motivates you? What gets you out of bed every day for the last, 25, 30 years, even more? Because these were the older partners, the founding partners. And it was amazing to hear the feedback, really to get a bit of an understanding of what drives people. And you might say, oh, okay, audit firm money. But it was really the motivation behind each and every one of them that made it a success story. And together, how their vision and what they wanted the firm to be resulted in them getting so far. And I think what is so interesting is that it is different for every person, but yet ultimately is so important to the success of the team you're in. And what I think is really interesting is that commitment can go so far to want you to stay there no matter what, to keep pushing, to keep driving the success. So I think another point which is really important is that motivation and that behavior then drives a consequence, ripple across the team. I don't know if you've ever had this experience, but when you push people and they see that you're motivated and you've bought into the vision and you've bought into the goal, and then they are participating with you because they feel that goal, that they feel that drive as well. I think really, when we speak about every day informally, I think you're mentoring people, you're sometimes coaching people if you're working with your teams, and you're a lot of the time it's sort of how well are you reaching and sort of connecting with people, and what factors do you take into consideration when you're making decisions? How much importance do you give to what people are feeling and what people are thinking, and what is driving that thought process themselves? When you are dealing with people, what I've learned is a very, I think, a very basic important lesson is you're only as good as your team. So whether you could be the best manager, the best leader, but you're only as good as the people supporting you underneath you. So if you're not ready to listen to them, and if you're not ready to let them tell you sometimes because you don't always get it right, then you are going to find a situation where you will have people who feel they are not really being listened to, or being maybe not being totally honest with. So I'll give you an example of a situation where somebody may have to impart some bad news in an organization. And how that news is channeled and how that news is communicated can have a big impact on how the team you are responding to and giving that information reacts. So I think it is really understanding what it is that people are feeling. And that's not always easy to do. You can't always read people. I think we mentioned in the intro that I'm halfway through a certification on a tool that we use called business chemistry. And this is really what is interesting because it's very similar to this. It's understanding people's behavior. And one thing they mentioned is, you know, we say treat people as you would like to be treated. But over here, the difference is treat people how they would like to be treated themselves and how you sort of adapt behavior and how you are working with people, understanding the same, how the impact that that's having on them. The last one, as we said, was really allowing, if you like, you know, building rapport, managing relationships effectively, and getting a good understanding of the people you're working with, and understanding also the sort of the behaviors and what is needed to put, you know, your team in place. Even in terms of managing relationships on a daily basis, how well does that work and how do you do it? How can you do it better? What is interesting is these, so of the five components, the first three are really about sort of self-management, so it's relating to yourself. Whereas the last two are more focused on relationship with others and sort of how you build them. And what's interesting about emotional intelligence is it can be learned. It's not something that if you don't have it, it's never going to come to you. It can be learned. What you need to build it and what you need to grow it, it's time and it's commitment. And it is understanding the journey and where you want to get to. I don't know if some of you may have been sort of exposed to a personal development journey where you have a plan, where you've mapped out your development goals, or maybe it's something you've read about or something you'd like to do eventually. But this is in terms of sort of being able to obtain those skills. They don't come naturally to everybody, and everybody will have different sort of different skills in the course of their career. And effectively, what the basis of this was is saying, look, these are the basic ingredients for any leader. And to have those just gives you the right tools to start with. They're not the only tools, but they are a key component which helps in terms of sort of making sure that if tomorrow you are in a position of leadership, that you do have that skill set if you want, or you are displaying the skills. I'm going to stop here because I'm like talking. I just want to ask, I don't know, do you have any questions or any comments, or who of you work in teams here, or maybe just for me to understand a bit about you? Okay. What I'm speaking about, does it resonate with you? Are you like, I'm seeing quite a few of you nodding your head, so I'm hoping that's a good thing. But do you find yourself in these situations and, you know, you have to, I think sometimes it's a bit of how do you act on the spot? Now, I don't know, I'd be curious to understand maybe your some feedback, because it's always very interesting to me to learn.
Down the wrong route. When you are hitting that keyboard and you're a 25-year-old thinking you know it all and you're sending it out and you've gone down the wrong route and then you learn. So with experience and maturity, you learn to rein yourself in, basically.
Yes.
So yes, definitely. There are some emails that you should read and say, okay, I'll look at this tomorrow. I need to sleep on it and snore on it as well.
It's very true. And I think, I mean, you mentioned, and I'm not covering it in this topic, but you mentioned sort of generational workforce differences. And, you know, very often some people would like to say it's a millennial thing, just forget it, you're not going to get through to them. But the truth is, you know, the previous generation will say it's not a millennial, you were equally as bad. So it's generational, but every generation has I think, the pros and the cons. But I think where the biggest change is possibly, and I know we have a we have some people here with us from the education as well. So from education as well, which I think is even the even bigger challenge there, because you are then, you know, educating the future workforce. So by the time they come to the organizations, we're like, okay, now how do we deal with, nobody gives us an instruction book to deal with them. Would anyone else like to share some experiences of
I like the part about empathy very much.
Okay.
Because it belongs to everybody. Yes. You need not be working with teams.
No.
Because there are people all around you all the time. Does it mean empathy? You have to go very deep in people's personal lives sometimes? And how much
I think
should you keep a barrier between the people around you and yourself, you know?
I say when, so within an HR profession, which is the profession I come from, I always find that it is a very personal decision on how much of a relationship the person wants to have with you. And very often, I think you do not need to dive too deeply into a person to the point that they feel uncomfortable. But very often,
or you will feel uncomfortable.
Will exactly,
as well,
exactly,
because it belongs to the emotional part of you.
Yes, and in fact, we very often, I tell people when they come to have a chat, because people like to speak sometimes, I say, you know, I can tell you as far as I am qualified to help you. Because then sometimes if it is really personal and it is something really important to the person and impactful on their behavior, then you know, we bring in people who can help better. But yes, you are very right. It is also difficult because sometimes people struggle to open up. So I think it's also about creating the right environment that they feel comfortable enough to do so.
You will be the right person for people to share the inner feelings,
yes,
as well.
Yes.
Because sometimes that will help to get them along with their work later on.
It is. I think it's possibly one of the hardest, most challenging jobs is really doing that, because you really want people to feel that they have a place to come to. But on the other hand, you also need to balance that with being able to do what you are there to do as well.
For both of you, I think.
You know, it's because you could end up, which is fine, but sometimes it can be a challenge.
Thank you. It's a fine lecture. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, I don't know if there are any other comments or... Okay, and I think just yes, of course.
I want to respond to that, sorry, mm-hmm. If I may.
Okay.
Thank you. My name is Leszek. I also spent quite a lot of time with corporations and then on my own. And I really strongly believe we need leaders. We need good leaders. And the good leaders need those skills to be good leaders. But there are a lot bad leaders. I agree. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of bad leaders who don't have the empathy, who just fight among themselves, who show up, you know, as without integrity. Mm-hmm. But we need good leaders.
And I think, just touching on the points you're raising, I think the concept of the transparency as well and the honesty and integrity, I think, you know, also brought into this are key and becoming more and more relevant. Okay, just really to so I originally I thought we might have the room set up slightly different. So I'm just going to ask you to join me if you want to. It's not mandatory. In a little exercise, which is we're just going to hand out sheets and you have a biro, and so there's no right or wrong answer. So, and you don't need to share them. I'm not going to ask anyone to stand up and make a presentation. But really, I just want to show you. So when we're running a workshop or just asking people, okay, let's take some time to do some self-reflection and some self-awareness. So, and I will share the names of the books with you I've used as well. But really, and I'm going to bring up the points and just explain the key to it as well. But what I want you to really get out of this, and I think we can just spend about 5 minutes on it, is really understanding yourself. So I'm just going to... So this is the sheet you have. And then you'll notice that you have a sort of like a option to choose. And I'm going to leave this here, but I'm going to read it to you just so in case it's not so visible. But we're talking about how often do you display this behavior? So just have a think. And as I said, you're not going to read them out. You're not going to share them with us. It's just for you to get a bit of a taste of the process. So if it's always, there are no exceptions, you do this without thinking. This is always what I do. Routinely is you would, you know, it would be a very rare occasion where you wouldn't do it. Sometimes, you know, when you really think you're doing it well, it's what you would be doing. And rarely, it would be very obviously unusual for you to do it, and never, you would never do it. So just, you can just take around 5 minutes, just read them and just, as I said, there's no right or wrong, and I really want to stress this, there's no, you know, sort of right or wrong answer. It's purely how you adapt and how you behave in these situations. If I can just take you through if I can just ask you to take a look at this sheet and what really, as you're going through them, sort of how you've assessed and sort of what you've taken time. I mean, can I just understand from maybe, can I just ask you to quieten down a bit? Generates a lot of conversation. Had any of you done this before, something similar to this before? Have any of you ever? Have you ever done something similar before? Have you ever taken the time to just sort of assess?
Yes, I actually believe a lot about the importance of emotional intelligence, and I have been working on it for these past 3 years. So there are certain things that
Can I ask you please to quieten down? Thank you.
Okay, so like all behavior, once it becomes innate, it takes a while until you get used to it. But like everything, once you consciously make an effort to do things in a certain way, then it's, at the end of the day, it becomes part of who you are.
Very true.
But I do, I emphasize a lot on honesty and on integrity and on values, because that is the root, I believe, of emotional intelligence. Once you establish what your values are, mm-hmm. and what you base your values on, mm-hmm. Whether it's human connections, whether it's integrity, whether it's honesty, whether it's a mixture of all, mm-hmm. once you establish what your values are and you stick by them through thick and thin, no matter your situation, mm-hmm. Then that's when you reach a level of emotional intelligence, because at the end of the day, it's about finding a balance between the situation at hand, let's say at a workplace, mm-hmm. and at a workplace, the organization has its own values, its own mission statement, let's put mm-hmm. it like that. And sometimes they're not aligned with your personal values. Mm-hmm. You have an option. As a person, you have an option. You can either stay or you can mm-hmm. leave.
Yes.
And it takes courage to make that decision.
Very true.
But that is part of emotional intelligence. Sometimes people lack the courage to make those choices.
Very true. Thank you. So was there someone else who... Okay, so just to wrap up, so this is, and in the slides that we will share with you, you have the book, and if you like to read, you can purchase the book as well. What this does is it sort of gives you a score based on those statements. So the idea is, and you feel free to look at them as well after this session. I mean, today was a short, if you like, taster on really on emotional intelligence, but just to share with you some basic concepts. But what it does is it just takes the scores and tries to give you a bit of guidance in terms of, okay, maybe you may not be as good as you are at reading your own emotions, but maybe stronger at reading others. So, for example, if you've scored a 10 or a less, where you've answered never or rarely to most of the questions, that there is the opportunity to focus on recognizing the distinction, for example, of and what is generating possibly maybe different emotions. Whereas if you've answered more with sometimes, then you are able to start recognizing the emotion sometimes. Routinely is where you're not there yet, because you typically do it, but there are still areas for improvement or change or adapting. And then always is where it's sort of basically you are an individual who is fully aware and has a high level of self-awareness and are able to then sort of recognize and understand the behavior. So I think that really brings me to the end of my session. And today, the idea was for me really to within the time we've been given to spend together, is really just give you a bit of an insight. And the truth is, we could talk for hours and hours about emotional intelligence and go into different areas. But it's been very interesting, and thank you for your interactions. I hope you found this session useful. If you have any other comments or questions, more than welcome to take them. But that's really it from my end. So thank you very much. It's been a pleasure speaking to you. Thank you.